It is 7 o'clock.
I got 1 minute.
Okay. So I'm looking at that clock over there, 7:01.
Oh, okay.
Well, medium red you like. Something.
But, like, I'm...
I know, you're
whatever.
Fine.
I'm whatever.
I'm ready to go.
Yeah.
You're on.
You don't have...
Okay, I'm going to call this regular meeting of the Board of Education to order at 7:01 p.m. We'll take a moment of silence to be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. And if anybody wants to sing Go Cubs Go, that'd be okay too. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I'd like to thank Rod Waddell for being here from Jefferson High School's AV, helping with the AV equipment tonight for the broadcast on Channel 20. So, Rod, thank you for being here. Okay. So let's call the roll.
Ms. Jackson, Mr. Rollins.
Here.
Mr. Scrivano.
Here.
Mrs. McCulloch.
Here.
Mr. Siegel.
Here.
Mr. Connor.
Here.
Ms. Jessica Bethel.
Here.
With 6 present, 1 absent, we have a quorum.
We'll move on to our petitions and communication portion of our meeting, where we invite the public to make comments. The First Amendment of the United States of the Constitution guarantees the right of citizens to petition their government, as well as provides for freedom of speech. Also, the Illinois School Code requires that there be a time at regular and special meetings for public comment. Thus, we are following those mandates during this petitions and communications portion of our agenda. According to our board policy 2.230, the public comments portion of the meeting is limited to a total of 30 minutes. The board will not respond to comments at this time. If it is appropriate, you'll be contacted in a timely manner by staff in response to your questions. In order to allow sufficient time for the board to conduct our meeting, we are requesting that you comply with the guidelines that are posted, and each speaker will be allowed no more than 2 minutes. It's not appropriate to address individual board members or individual administrators or discuss matters that would otherwise be confidential in such open meetings. I will call tuners. I think we just have 2 speakers tonight, so I don't have to read that part. But I want to point out that we have a clock on the wall to help you with your 2 minutes timing, and we thank you for your interest and your cooperation with our guidelines. Our first speaker tonight is Kelly Gaday, to be followed by Joanna Adams. Kelly, if you will hit the red button or make the light come on there for the microphone. Thank you. There should be a button on down there. There you go.
There we go.
You got it.
Is that it?
Yep.
Thank you for your time this evening. My name is Kelly, and I have four-year-old twins that are currently at Fairview right now, and I just wanted to share my story and how we're affected. One of my girls has been diagnosed with cerebral palsy, and she has some special needs in which requires a para to be with her during school time in order to be safe on the playground, in order to be safe in the gym, in order to eat her food safely without choking. All of these things require that someone be with her one-on-one, mostly because with lots of other children around, it's easy for her to lose her balance and fall, and it's mostly a safety issue. The concern here, my experience last year when we started her pre-K-3, was that there was not a para available for her when we started preschool in October. It took about 6 weeks for that process to occur, and in that time, there were lots of very helpful folks at the school. However, it was very inconsistent care that was provided for her, simply because it takes time for a 3- and 4-year-old to get to know new people and to trust new people when they're worried they're going to fall or hurt themselves. So the concern for me last year was that there wasn't anyone available on a consistent basis to meet her IEP that was provided for her. This year I kind of hope that would be that would not be an issue. However, her para was not asked to return this year, and there was another para provided for her who is now no longer available. So we're now in a situation where we don't have a para for her, and we're currently looking for somebody, but there are not any applicants and have not been for at least 2 weeks that I'm aware of. So right now they're trying to meet her minutes as best as they can, but it's being provided by folks in the school that are being paid a heck of a lot more than a para would be. And she's getting her minutes, but at this point in time it's inconsistent, and I just feel that this is a pattern following from last year to this year. So that's my concerns I have. I'd like for us to consider hiring more folks to have for these kids that are in need at schools.
Thank you, Kelly.
For your time.
Thank you. Joanna Adams.
Hi there. My name is Joanna, and I work as a paraprofessional at Fairview School. I love working with children, knowing that I am making a difference in someone's life. What I dislike about my job is this right here. I hate public speaking, and it feels demeaning standing in front of all you individuals in a higher economic status as me, groveling for my job. I do it, however, because I am passionate about this. I want to talk about how the district's proposal for our new contract affects me. I did the math on this. After 17 years working for the district, I only make $13.53 per hour. 3 years from now, if your proposal goes through, I will be making 53 cents more per hour. However, with the insurance hike, I will be bringing home $69 less per month. This is ridiculous. I should not be going backwards. Now I want to speak about how this affects the district. There are over 40 para positions that are not being filled. This proposal will not help that situation. This means IEPs are not being effectively met. This leaves the district vulnerable to lawsuits, which could be very costly. Now I want to speak how this affects the community. Rockford has a huge crime problem. I'm sure it's no news to you that crime and poverty are related. The district is paying hundreds of its employees poverty wages. This means they are directly contributing to the poverty and crime problem in Rockford. I want to end this with the assumption that the district is throwing out this absurd proposal purposely so that they can come in with another that advances us little to none, leaving us to think we are getting a good deal. I say shame on you, Rockford School District 205, for exploiting your workers. The district has a surplus of money and making many school improvements. I think we should be part of that movement forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Joanna. Are there any board member comments at this time? Mr. Connor.
I've got my flag tie on in honoring our veterans on the 11th, and I want to thank everybody for their service to their country.
Thank you. Ms. McCullough.
I'm my red, white, and blue on, and ditto.
Okay.
But I also want to say that how fortunate I was to be principal for a day at Whitehall at Elementary School. And as a board member, I think it's just crucial, and I haven't been able to do it every year, to be in the schools with the students during the day when they're there and to see what the staff members as well as administration and students and, you know, just how the whole process works, and so that when we're making decisions from a different level, keeping all that in mind. So thank you for a great day. I appreciate the school and what they had to offer.
Any other board member comments? Okay. If not, we'll then move on to the consent portion of our agenda, including the following consent items: the meeting minutes of October 25th, 2016, and October 22nd, the strategic planning meeting, payroll, accounts payable, purchase orders, contracts under $10,000, construction bid pay request log and travel, the bid recommendations for HVAC, water treatment chemicals and service, and the East and Jefferson dust collection bids, the Freedom of Information log. Is there a motion and a second to approve these consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Siegel. Are there any consent items that board members wish to have pulled for separate consideration? Seeing none, I'll have the coordinator then call the roll on the approval of the consent items.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scirrano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
We are now on to the closed session consent agenda items, including the HR organizational report and addendum, and the student discipline, in which the board adopts and accepts the hearing officer's findings and recommendations in the following cases in which the students expelled or suspended are prohibited from being on school grounds and school-sponsored activities without the prior written permission of the principal. The expulsion for student GDM 4015-17 is held in abeyance contingent upon an expulsion and abeyance agreement for the remainder of this school year. Students 4010-17, 4011-17, 4014-17, 4016-17, and 4017-17 are expelled for the remainder of this school year. Students 4012-17 and 4013-17 are expelled for the remainder of this school year and the entire 2017-18 school year. And the following closed session consent items for EIAs, students 3045, 3047, 3049, 3051, 3052, 3053, 3055, 3056, 3057, 3058, and 3059. Is there a motion and a second to approve these closed session consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Siegel. Are there any items that any board member would like to have pulled for separate consideration? Mr. Rollins?
10 and 11.
10 and 11. Okay. Any others? So I'll then have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of the items not pulled, which would be the HR organizational report.
Mr. Scirrano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
I'll now take a motion and a second to approve the closed session agenda items, the student discipline, and EIAs.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. McCulloch. There is no discussion. I have the coordinator then call the roll on the approval of items 10 and 11 or closed session.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Abstain.
Mr. Scirrano?
Yes.
The motion passes with 5 yeses, 1 abstain, and 1 absent.
Thank you. Our next item on our agenda is Dr. Jarrett's superintendent's report.
Thank you, Mr. Scirrano. I wanted to highlight a practice that we are engaged in with our special programs, and we happen to be working today. Board Member Rollins is a member of the committee, but all of our board members have chosen to be part of this. But Ms. Alt and also Dr. Saltis are leading the way, working with community members, students, alumni, faculty, to build a 5-year plan to improve the quality of our Montessori program, to build on some of the incredible strengths that already exist, as well as look at opportunities to strengthen that program. So I want to express my appreciation for the community members and students, faculty, board members, everyone that is rolling up their sleeves to be part of that process. And it's always exciting to kick that off. We kicked off our other 4 special programs last year. We wanted to let Montessori get into their new building at the former Marsh Elementary. And I was excited to see such an energized group today. And I look forward to the work that group will do. Thank you.
Move on to committee reports. Ms. McCulloch, the Education Committee report.
Education Committee has not met since our previous board meeting. We will meet in this room next Tuesday, November 15th at 5:30 p.m. And the agenda will be posted on the website.
Mr. Rollins, Finance Committee report.
Finance Committee met last night in this room at 5:30 p.m. We first heard from our auditors. It was not really a presentation of the audit, which is not ready yet, but it was kind of some high points of a teaser of what the audit's going to look like. So the good news is they did say that we will be getting a clean audit opinion this year, which is good. And the only other 2 things that I guess I'll point out is, or pick out, They're saying that we will have a decrease in operating funds, a deficit in operating funds. This is for the fiscal year ending this past June 30th of $960,597. That is entirely because of what the state did with CPPRT. We've talked about this, but just a reminder, the state notified us at the end of the year that they determined that they had, and not just us, every government agency in the state of Illinois that receives CPPRT was notified that the state decided that it had overpaid CPPRT and that they will require repayment from the district of $2.8 million. Now, we didn't actually have to pay that last year, but because it relates to last year's payments, the auditors are requiring it to recognize, requiring us to recognize it in last year's financial statements. So that's going to be a reduction in last year's financial statements of $2.8 million, which again then gives us this decrease in the fund balance relating to operating funds of $960,000. Mr. McConaughey gave us an update to the Finance Committee, where again I think we talked a little bit more about the CPPRT. Ms. Stacy Talbert Scott gave us a budget variance forecast. So she or the administration is showing at this point what they're trying to do is they're trying to reforecast during the year as they become aware of things that have changed. So in addition, and we've talked about this too, in addition to that $2.8 million that I talked about, the state decided that since they had overpaid everybody last year, that they didn't want to be in the same position going forward, so they're going to reduce payments going forward from what they had previously projected, and that looks like a total of about $4.6 million that they're going to reduce our payments this year below what they had originally told us we were going to get. And so that's a negative budget variance of $4.6 million. In addition, because of the decision not to take the TIF and new construction, that's an additional $550,000. We did on the upside, we got the increase in general state aid of about $8.9 million. When you balance all of that out, they're looking at a positive adjustment at this point, of about on the revenue side of $3.6 or $3.7 million. Now they had some negative adjustments as well, including salaries, employee benefits, purchase services, and capital outlay and some other objects. So right now where we're standing at is that they've adjusted the budget in a positive way by $1.9 million. And that's where they think that we stand at this point. And then Ms. Bessonen gave us the fiscal year 17 first quarter treasurer's report, and I forgot to look to see whether that's part of the packet for the board. It may not be, but if it's not as part of this agenda, I'm sure it'll be coming forward in the next meeting. And the committee will meet again in this room at first Monday of the month, which is December 5th at 5:30 p.m.
Thank you. Mr. Connor, the Operations Committee.
Operations met a week ago at 6:30. The main topics were presented by Mr. Schmidt, and the first was the status on the capital plan. And the projection for the plan is that the 10-year plan will be basically done in 7 years, which would be 2020. And so it looks to be in good shape in that way. We basically have paid almost 63% to date, and we're ahead of schedule, and the budget is right on the money. So from the capital plan standpoint, we're doing pretty well. Another big topic was there's a new system for computer-aided design, and basically the net of this is that we can track virtually everything on site, on each site across the district, and it's not just things like the actual layouts where you have everything from safety to where things are mechanically, but that we could also do things like take inventory of IT, and that would include smart boards. And so one of the things that I've asked the administration to do is look into a couple things. Number one is on the IT side, data export capabilities, any potential use with, say, finance and other areas where we could do planning, and also to make sure that we had the proper IT support and staffing for things like inventory, because there's a great many areas that can use it. And in a related area, we have life cycle reports now. So we actually have a timeline for all our life cycle reports. And the first will be roofing, which will be, or which was last time, then windows in December. And there's a whole schedule that's out on the out on the website under operations. The good news here is that we think that we have both dollar savings as well as some efficiencies that we're going to get through the plan on the life cycle. And it's other things like HVAC, electrical, painting, flooring, et cetera. So to me, this is good news, and really kudos to Mr. Schmidt and staff for doing a really good job. And what I'd like to ask is that other areas, again, back to the computer-aided design, if they could use it, especially, again, IT and so forth, even there are, is the ability to track entrances, all kinds of things, so that I think that from a safety standpoint, there's a lot of planning that we can do. So I would say kudos to Mr. Schmidt and his group in particular. Also, there was a number of items that were talked about that ranged from plans for air conditioning as well as overall productivity within the school district. And there was one of the concerns was around how to do optimal staffing. And one thing I pointed out in committee is that this will be driven by the education side and that we have to have an overall plan. It's not really an operational kind of consideration. It's really an educational consideration. So I think that is a topic that will come up. I've mentioned that to Dr. Schroeder on the curriculum side for planning and to make sure that that's driven on the educational side. I have a feeling that's one that will come up on a regular basis. But I was very pleased with the planning and, again, appreciate all the progress that's been made on this end. Our next meeting will be the first Tuesday, which I believe is December 6th, and it will be at 6:30 in this room. Thank you.
The computer-aided design system for the building sites, is that a capability we have now, or is a capability where he's asking us for?
This is a great question. Right. It's actually something we have right now that's okay. been implemented. Okay. And those that want to see it, there are diagrams. And I think there's an...
he's walking up yeah, slowly. That, go ahead, Mr. Schmidt.
That there's some, there are a few things he wants with it, but basically not everything is done. But if you look at the plans, a lot of what has to be done is data entry. So there is some detail, but I'll let Mr. Schmidt.
It's an interactive system that's net request that the board approved about 2 years ago. And what it does is it combines our AutoCAD files along with any databases or any Excel spreadsheets that we have together, along with any pictures. And it's layers. Once we implement the base plan, the site plan, the roof plan, then we can bring in layers of that to show where all the electrical runs are, where all the panels are, where all the strobes are, annunciators, fire alarm panels, and then we can attach pictures to it. And then there's also tables that we can create queries off of that to look at our life cycle and our replacement schedule on there, along with putting in detailed information.
That life cycle thing should be great. Ms. McCulloch, did you have a question?
Well, actually, I don't see on our committee reports the building disposition, and I know that Mr. Connor had a meeting, and I was hoping you would give board an update on that.
Okay, right? Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Schmidt.
Yeah, there's really the building disposition committee, frankly, had a lack of a quorum, so we were supposed to meet, but there is no report, essentially. However, out of that, I will say that the IGA, or Intergovernmental Agreement, between the district and the city regarding Walker has been presented to the city legal department, and I don't think we have a date yet on the return on that. Mr. Schmidt?
Get you a chair.
Yeah.
Wheelchair.
We've sent that over to Todd Cagnoni, and he's reviewing it with the staff over there for the community and development. So we're waiting on a response from him. He said he would get back to me this week on that.
So that would be Walker. And then in terms of our intention, we have reached out to the aldermen that have the schools that will be closing so that we can have some public meetings, but we don't have a schedule yet. As soon as we hear back from the aldermen, we will set that up. It is our intention to set up the building disposition with the first, with the schools where they have possibilities to be acquired by the park district. That will be our top priority. And so that would be Thompson, White Swan, I'm trying to think. I know I'm missing one. New Milford and Stiles are the ones that I forget. Those are the ones that I think are the ones that are of most interest by the park district. So they are our priority right now, obviously, along with Walker, where we have the IGA, and we are on a schedule on that. To date, we're basically on schedule, and my sense of it is that we can cut the time for the actual RFP that the city will manage because there's been time for people to respond to this point. They just don't have the specs on the RFP. So I think that process actually will be sped up. Yep.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? If not, we'll move on then to our action items for tonight. First action item is the Kids at the Core agreement for Haskell School. This is the professional development, I think, for the staff for STEM and STEAM initiatives under the Haskell School year-round program. Mrs. Ault presented it. Is there a motion and a second to approve this?
So moved.
Moved second. By Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Any questions or discussion? Not, have the coordinator call the roll.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCullough?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
Our next action item is two grants, and I just want to ask the board if sorry if we do these together. All right. $10,000 grant acceptance, USTA. That's the United States Tennis Association, if I remember right. Facilities grant to fix some tennis courts that Dr. Wolf talked about. $40,000 game time grant acceptance. Is there a motion and a second to accept these grants?
So moved.
Moved by second. Mr. Connor, second by Mr. Siegel. Any questions or discussion? Not, have the coordinator call the roll.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
Our next action item is a Northern Illinois University Special Education Bilingual Endorsement. That was presented by Mrs. Cyrus. Is there a motion and a second to approve this?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Ellens. Any questions or discussion? Now I'll have the coordinator call the roll.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch? Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
Next action item is the intergovernmental agreement with the County of Winnebago regarding the Kishwaukee School Development Project for land acquisition.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Any questions or discussion? Mr. Connor.
Just the same comment I made last time. I want to thank the county board for contributing to this. This is an important investment in a neighborhood that truly needs it, and we think this will have a material improvement, not just to the school, but to the neighborhood. And to have governmental partners that have agreed to this, I think, is a great step forward. And again, I applaud the county for doing this and want to thank them.
Yep. Ditto. Any questions or discussions beyond that? If not, I'll the coordinator call the roll on the approval of this IGA.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
The next item on the action list is all real estate. And do you want to do these separately or together?
I think the purchase.
Do the purchase separate? Okay. Yeah, let's do that. Okay. So I'll take a motion and a second then to approve item F, which is the real estate purchase at 706 South 3rd Street.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Any questions or discussion? Okay, I'll have the coordinator then call the roll on the approval of item F, which is the purchase of 706 South 3rd Street.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
Thank you. I'll take a motion in a second to approve the eminent domains at the following addresses: 513 Catlin Street, 619 Catlin Street, 510 Gregory Street, 624 South 3rd Street, and 603 Union Street. Is there a motion? And
so
a
second moved.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Any questions or discussions? Mr. Connor.
I think always with eminent domains, people know, I've said it repeatedly, that it's our last. It's really our last resort, but I think we've got so many. I hate to ask Mr. Schmidt to hobble up one more time, but if you don't mind, Mr. Schmidt, I think
it's part of his wellness plan.
Yeah, it's part of his wellness plan. I think. I think it does deserve a little comment because we have five properties that we're doing this.
These are all in various states where we reached out to the individual landowner and we made an offer. They've countered, and we just couldn't meet in the middle. Some of these are to clear up some title searches out there. One of them, we really can't find the owner, so that's another one that's sitting out there. So these are in different things, that different states of it. Just to let you know, when we have three that new ones on the agenda for tonight, one of those was a previous eminent domain that we've come back and we've reached an agreement with the owner. So it doesn't mean that these always are going to go into the eminent domain process, that we're still reaching to with them. So.
Okay. Thanks. Did we get a motion in a second? We need to do the roll.
Yes.
Roll. Yeah. Maybe call the roll on the eminent domain.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Mr. Siegel?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses, 1 absent.
We are now on new business. Administration is requesting the board suspend the rules to consider our first item, which is the paper cut software purchase. Is there a motion and a second to suspend the rules to consider item 15A?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Siegel. Any questions or discussion? Mr. Connor.
A little background.
On the suspension?
Yeah. The timing.
Martin, oh, there he is. Okay, he's waving at me. I'm looking over here.
Yes, the background on that is we always had this software in as part of the planned implementation. We pulled it out as a separate item so that there would be more competition in the responses for the invitation to bid. And for another reason, too, depending upon which distributor and which equipment supplier won the bid, there are different variations of this Follow Me type software that fit Canon's as opposed to Xerox as opposed to Minolta. So we pulled it out as a separate item, knowing that we would reintroduce it at this time so that we could finish the package and begin the implementation. We would like to begin the installation and training of the equipment this month. This software is an integral part of that, so we're requesting that you suspend the rule for two readings so we can keep the project on time.
Okay. All right. Mr. Connor?
Well, I guess it begs the question of if it was planned, why it couldn't have been read in last time. Is it because the bids just now came back? Is that the idea?
No, you're right. The bids came back last month. We should have gotten it on the last meeting date. We did want to make sure we had a walkthrough with the winning vendor, however, so that they could physically see the placement, the networking, touch base with our IT department. The last thing we wanted to do was ask for approval on a software that IT would say, hey, that's not going to work because of this, that, or the other thing. While all the equipment was spec'd originally to be compatible with Follow Me software, we wanted that in-house affirmation before we moved on.
Ms. McCullough?
So the reason this wasn't done parallel or in tandem with the other purchases is because you wanted to see who got the... I'm just not understanding.
Sure. Let me explain that because it is an unusual situation. The Follow Me software is very common, but there are different versions of it, kind of like Apple and Mac. There would be different versions of software. Only in this case, the software that we needed to purchase, we had to be sure we picked the right one to go with whatever vendor's equipment won the bid. In this case, Canon equipment won the bid. Not all the Follow Me software packages will work with Canon. You have to match them up. And the other part of that is that type of software is not sold to the end user. That type of software has to be purchased by us through a distributor. And so we wanted to keep the competition open by not specifying one proprietary type of software. That opened it up to many more bidders. It was quite successful, and we had very good competition on the bid. Knowing that we would come back to you, saving the dollars to do that, to pick the right match for the equipment in our software brand and offering so that everything would work together when we finally went with the implementation.
So we always knew that it was going to be in a...
In fact, I believe even legal recommended we pull it out so we get more competition.
Good. And did we have a budgeted amount for it, and did this come in under it?
Yes, it did.
By how much, do you know? Just curious.
I don't know the exact dollars.
That's okay.
I think about $100,000 was budgeted, and I think it's at 88.
86,364. So, and that's awesome.
Mr. Rollins?
I mean, this goes to the substance, but I want to get it on the table before we vote on whether to expedite. So I cannot for the life of me figure out where you pulled it out. The IFB 16-68 included in the specifications at 5DF, all machines should allow for Follow Me printing job release where the print job submitted to a device should be retrievable from any of the devices on site. Software licenses and configuration, if needed, should be included in the proposal. There were three addendum issued, and none of those addendum changed that specification. So at what point did we pull that out?
As a part of reviewing all of the bid documents and forms, because some of the pricing seemed to vary dramatically, we actually did contact every single last one of the bidders that at that time was deemed a responsible bidder and asked them to confirm their pricing and asked them to confirm their authentication method as well as software. And so we actually have that information in what we call a bidder discussion record to ensure that we were able to be able to tell which part belonged to what, because some vendors did actually include it in with the whole price. So we do have that information because we had to individually contact them.
I've got a concern here that the specifications required that this software be included, and that we awarded it apparently to a company that didn't include the software, and are now awarding them a second contract for $85,000 for the software.
So, excuse me, as we looked at the cost for just the leasing and the equipment, and then even with the addition of the software, Marco is still the lowest provider for that whole entire package. So when I just went back and looked, as I mentioned, there were some that, not some, actually all of them had that information in there. They just presented it differently. And so I would have to disagree with you when you say that that information was not in there, because that information was included, as well as we asked them to ensure that the equipment is able to have one of those types of softwares. It can be Equitrack, it can be the other Follow Me, but it was really up to the district to determine which one was best for us.
The specification said software licenses and configuration, if needed, should be included in the proposal.
There's much more software included in with the multifunction copier device than that piece. As you recall,
this was part of the specification on the Follow Me printing job release. That was all one sentence. That's two sentences under specification 5DF. So did you just say that some of the bidders did include that software license?
Of them included the software license. It's just some of them included it as a monthly value. Some of them included it as a lump sum, which is why we actually took the time to contact and document that, because when we see various swings, such as one was $32,000, well, theirs was $32,000 times three. So it would have been an annual cost of a little bit over three-year cost a little bit over $90,000. Some gave us just a lump sum of $100,000. And so they all did include that within their proposal.
So after receiving the bids, you backed it out and decided not to award?
Correct, because at the time we were not sure as to which authentication method we were going to choose, whether it was going to be PIN or swipe, as well as which one of the softwares would be best suited. So, for example, the two that we listed in there as an example, either one of those actually work with the Canon software, but after information technology did the analysis, it comes about that the paper cut would actually be a better fit than Equitrack for what we would want to use it with, and all of the network and all those other types of requirements that are well above my head and understanding.
So there's two different specifications here. One refers to the Follow Me printing job release, that's F, and then G refers to Equitrack paper cut or owner approved monitoring software. Those appear to me to be two different things, because they're listed as two different specifications.
So they're actually the same. One, so the Follow Me, as it sounds, allows a person to print, and then you could go and retrieve your print job. But it also provides a lot of data and statistics on who's printing, where they're printing, how long, how many pages was the job. I mean, just a lot of data. So when you see the two different points, it's actually talking about the same software, but these are the requirements that we're wanting from the software to be able to give us the proper data, as well as allow for the security of the Follow Me printing.
Could I just ask our general counsel?
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Reviewed any of this?
Yeah, because there's no addendum.
Yes, I have. And the software was before the bid was let that we talked about the software, so to make sure that it was competitive, so before the bid, when we were developing the bid, that was one of the concerns that was raised, that it was too narrow as far as specifying a particular type of software. So that's where it included in there the owner approved equal.
My question really is, did you review the issue about the fact that the specification seemed to require that the software be included, but then we awarded the contract without the software?
No, I did not.
Ms. McCullough.
And I'm not a lawyer, so I'm trying to understand, and I see Mr. in the same situation. So, legal, Ms. Hoadley. So, based on what Mr. Rounds has just told us and what's in the contract, and lacking any sort of addendum backing that out, the contract that we signed, this company should be providing the software for these services. Is that correct?
We do not yet have a contract with this company. We're still in the process of making sure that it is written. So we haven't signed it. We awarded a bid, but we are still in the process of drafting the contract.
So we as a board haven't voted on that?
You voted on awarding the contract consistent with the bid. And so that's what is happening. The confusing part with this is the addendum 3, which seems to change the specifications as whether or not you need that software. That was the lack of clarity on that. But there are still some issues that we're having outside counsel in preparation of the contract, the underlying contract.
But if they're bringing things in, I thought we were rushing this because things were coming in like November 8th or something, and we haven't signed a contract.
Signed the contract. What has happened, though, is the vendor did purchase copiers and have them ready to go, and IT has been working with the vendor to try to get the machines up and running. My understanding is you don't require the software, but it is a part. It doesn't. You don't need the software to run the copiers.
Right. This is more for tracking. You know, like she said, data collection. And I get that. But you might want that data right from the get-go when you put the copiers in. I get that as well. What I don't understand, and thank you, Mr. Rollins, for bringing this to attention, is how we're going to have them install when we don't have a signed contract, even though the board has approved it, and how if we have a contract or a bid that we've accepted and part of the bid is a software for this item, why now we're adding money to the bid. Because it wasn't like there was, you know how we have, what do we call that when we have add-ons, you know, if you,
right,
if alternate. You were an alternate, yeah. Mm-hmm. Because that's not on here, right? And so no. I'm truly stymied by whether or not this is all.
I think the confusion comes into the third addendum as to whether or not the software was required at the time, because that gave the language in it. And sorry, I don't have it before me, but Ms. Talbert-Scott, I think you do. And the language in the third addendum is what my understanding as to why the software was not included in the bid.
But then it shouldn't be in the contract.
Correct. And so that's where the negotiations are currently.
Well, we have a problem voting
for this. Mr. Connor, while Mrs. Talbert-Scott's looking that up.
So I'm trying not to be slow here, but is this discussion all germane to us speeding up and doing it all tonight, or is this on the actual content of the contract? Because the motion on the floor is about
suspending
the rules, and I totally understand there's questions, but it sounds to my ear like we're discussing the thing itself rather than speeding it up.
Well, my response to that would be that if we have questions and we vote down the contract, we voted down the contract. So what maybe the solution here is to slow things down and have legal look at it.
Yes.
So, okay. So I just want to make sure that that's what's on the table is we're discussing, in a sense, the merits of it so that you're saying to decide whether we're going to vote on it tonight. Okay. Just want to make sure.
Okay.
In that vein, can I ask, what is the risk of delaying? Because I know we have a lot of work that we're still doing in the buildings to make sure the rollout. Is there any risk of us pushing this back and just having this be a first reading since there are so many questions?
Superintendent, I absolutely agree. I mean, our plan was to get this rolling a little sooner because we have so many equipment needs and requests for printing and failing equipment in the building. But with the level of questions and need for additional information, I would concur that we would be more than happy to come back with additional information. And just as a understanding, this has been reviewed by our general counsel. They are, I'm sorry when I say that, I'm not ignoring Lori. excuse me, not you, Lori. I'm talking about Attorney Bischel, and he is aware of this, and actually he was waiting for the approval or what the outcome of tonight was going to be. So he is well aware of and has reviewed all of the addendums, all of the entire bid itself, and been the person working with the actual contract for the copiers and not the software part.
So I guess what I would offer, based on what Mr. Talbert-Scott just stated, is that you know, I would be willing to pull this as a, from an administrative perspective so that we have time to provide a more detailed explanation to the answers of the questions, and we'll treat this like a first reading, and we'll try to bring it back tomorrow, or not tomorrow, excuse me, 2 weeks from now, and hopefully have all those questions answered. I know there's a lot of work that's still going to be moving forward at the building level. We have people from the IT department here that are hard at work communicating with the building. So let's...
Can you do that if there's a motion on the floor?
Yeah, I think we need to go ahead and vote on the motion.
You need to vote on
it.
Yeah.
No, yeah. Well, if you just vote, or you could just...
We'll just vote it down.
You could just vote it down.
Yeah. Yeah. I think,
and then we don't have to take action tonight.
Correct. Yep. Yeah. I think the only thing I want to be clear on is that when we have the two times to review or have a first and second reading, should I assume that the discussion we've had is suffice for the board that this was an actual first reading?
Mm-hmm. It does.
Mm-hmm. Yep, I'm just saying, because we really did it under this.
Yeah.
Did it at Comstock?
That's fine. I'm okay.
Mr. Escobedo?
Yeah, so one quick question. As far as impact, so do we have equipment that's now being or soon to be removed, and now equipment is not going to be in place in time? Are we going to be in a situation
We do have Margaret Ryan that can probably speak specifically to the implementation at the building level. I know she has been actively involved in spearheading this, so she can answer that question, I assume.
Good evening. Hi. Thank you. Yes, I can. we are going to be selling back some of the copiers that are in the buildings, but that's going to be a swap when they bring the new devices in.
All right.
So the copiers that currently exist, we have, I believe, approximately 130 that are going to be, it's on their trade-in list, so they're going to be taking those with them. But currently what's in the district is still sustaining us, and we'll be able to continue to sustain through a two-week window.
So basically there will be no impact to the building level with this is delayed.
That's correct. Not at this time. And actually we've communicated with the principals as well that we are making a plan and we are scheduling this. So this is just going to help us be able to schedule more accurately and communicate with them.
Ms. McCulloch, do you have another question?
Oh, I do. So one of the reasons we have the working committees like the Operation Committee, which met last week, and this has been in place for, you said you've been looking at it for the last month. Did this come to operations, and did they have this conversation or have a conversation about it? Was it on the agenda? Because that's my understanding of what the committee is supposed to do.
It was led on the agenda a week ago.
Okay. All right. I'll have the coordinator then call the roll on the motion that's on the floor to suspend the rules for...
Mr. Siegel?
No.
Mr. Connor?
No.
Mr. Escobedo?
No.
Mr. Rollins?
No.
Mr. Scrivano?
No.
Mrs. McCulloch?
No.
The motion fails by 6 no's and 1 absent.
Okay, thank you. Our next item is the Youth Services Network Youth Court. Mr. Vosburg?
Okay.
Take it away.
I don't have a presentation tonight.
Okay.
I'm just available for questions. This was a proposal that was presented to the board in May of 2016, and we've had a lot of conversation in the community about the merits of the program and continuing forward. I know Dr. Jarrett has been involved with some of the conversations with board members. There's a commitment from the district for $10,000 to support the continued use of the program. A majority of that funding would be used to pay for training of students and staff members to monitor and implement the youth court model. We see an advantage to this in a couple areas. One, maintaining the work we've done with the county and working with the court systems Number two, as we all know, the enactment of Senate Bill 100 has kind of changed how we want to approach discipline, and so eventually this is something that we could model as peer jury for student discipline as well as some of the minor offenses that are used right now. And I think in the presentation in May, Mr. Carson mentioned the benefit of using this as an activity for our HS academies.
I would just add, thank you, Mr. Vosburgh. I think a key point of emphasis is because of the county being willing to make a fairly significant $27,000 financial commitment, this additional under $10,000 commitment on behalf of the district would fund the program for the remainder of the year, but really that is going to be a transition so that we can come up with a longer-term solution that will, as Mr. Vosburgh pointed out, pretty potentially change the focus and expand the focus to not just focus on the criminal side of things, but be expansive and inclusive of other student discipline issues so that students are engaged in a wider range of issues. So we think there is longer-term potential. We are also committed to making sure that this is not, this is something that we will have a, this will buy us the time to come up with a long-term solution for the program, whether we can do this internally moving forward. This is something that we want to make sure does not have a significant long-term financial impact that distracts from other core academic purposes. So we will either make a clear connection to core functions of the district, find an outside funding source, or we will determine at the end of this remaining year that we're going to do the work that it's not something that's a priority. But I think this gives us the time to do that properly. We should have had this conversation a year ago, candidly, and I think this commitment that the district is providing, in addition to the county's larger commitment, allows us to have the time to come up with a long-range plan that is successful for the district and the community.
Questions or discussion? Mrs. McCulloch?
Yeah, just on the fiscal impact piece of it, my understanding originally was this like a 50-some-odd thousand-dollar contract, so now 27 from the county and 10 from us. What is not going to happen with $20,000 less?
We shortened the year, so because it's delayed in implementation, there's less staff time needed.
Mr. Rollins.
So this was originally brought to the board, for those of you who haven't been on the board that long, in February 25th, 2014. It wasn't March, it was actually February, as an action item. That's when we acted on it. And it was brought to us by the county because this really has to do with the criminal justice system. And my recollection of how it was explained to us is that there would be no fiscal impact to the district because it was being paid for by a three-year grant. That was in February 2014, which is about 2.5 years ago, and it was a three-year grant. So my first question is, what happened to the three-year grant?
You can bring up Mary Ellen Comer. She's here.
And I think I can answer that, too. My understanding was it was in the implementation phase, so part of that three-year grant included the implementation. So it was the 13-14 school year, 14-15, and 15-16 school year. Now we're in the 16-17. So that grant is
no longer
in
So part of that grant actually was spent before we approved it in February 25th, 2014.
Correct, in identifying the appropriate program, and I believe they went to a bunch of other sites, similar sites, where it was being developed, was my understanding.
Okay. And so just so everybody understands what this is and what this isn't, we have a student code of conduct. And if students behave in ways that we feel are not in accordance with that student code of conduct, we discipline them under our student code of conduct. And what this was brought to us as, we also have students who commit crimes in our schools. And occasionally they are arrested by the Rockford police. That is a decision by the city of Rockford to arrest those people. If they commit a crime for which they can be arrested, this was a program, an innovative program, we were told in 2014, that was being proposed by the county and the city, the people who are responsible for our criminal justice system, to provide an alternative that would keep them out of jail. And we were asked on a no-cost basis to participate by allowing some of our students to be trained to act as a peer court. And there were people on the board then who didn't want to do it and were particularly reluctant because for various reasons. But they were convinced that, you know, it was of no cost to the district, and all we were doing was allowing our students to participate in this. Somehow now, you know, it's being presented as something that's our initiative or that's our program. This has nothing to do with our student discipline code. It has nothing to do with what we do with kids within our system. This is an alternative to the criminal justice system, which is run by Winnebago County. I'm also going to point out that, and I don't know the year, but quite a while ago, the voters of Winnebago County approved a 1% sales tax for Winnebago County for criminal justice, and they were promised that $2 million a year of that sales tax would be spent on alternative programs to keep people out of jail. $2 million a year is supposed to be spent on alternative programs to keep people out of jail. This sounds to me like an alternative program designed to keep people out of jail, but we're being asked to fund it. So I'm willing to have the conversation going forward. I understand that we're going to do this as a stopgap measure, that there may have been some miscommunications. But when we talk about whether or not this fits within our strategic plan, I mean, we are being told as a board that we want to focus on our strategic plan. And to me, this is a little bit of a test of how strongly the administration really believes that. Because if this is going to be presented as something that is part of our strategic plan to start funding the criminal justice system, you know, that does not seem to me to be where our focus ought to be. One of my problems, and I've had this conversation with members of the administration, one of the problems I have with these sorts of things is that these sorts of funding requests always get presented to us in the context of, you know, all the good that these funding requests can do. What doesn't get presented to us are the things that we've told our building staff we can't pay for. Science supplies, lab equipment, science labs. We're telling our staff we can't pay for those things. So when we talk about prioritizing and we talk about our strategic plan, when we have this discussion that you're talking about having in the future, we're going to have that discussion about what this district's priorities really are. In Mr. Carson's presentation back in May or whenever that was, this is a program that to date has helped 36 students. And we were asked to fund it for $52,000 originally. We've got it down to $10,000. 36 students. We're also starting to use the term academic return on investment. I mean, we're down to $10,000, but $10,000 for a program that in 2.5 years, apparently, has helped 36 students.
Any other comments, or Ms. McCullough?
I would gander that people would say that it's also helped the students who are participating in the whole process, and that's why we were trying to put it into the academic component. But I would ask the administration, do you have Ms. Kamaris speak to what the plan was for funding this moving forward, since the board was initially under the impression that there was a grant? What was the plan after 3 years? Is that okay?
When we wrote the grant, the district was involved because of the intergovernmental agreement that was between the district, the county, and the city. And in the grant, it was discussed over and over again, and we told the community foundation that the school district had agreed to pay when the grant was over.
So you told them that because you had that in writing, or that was just your understanding, or
no,
we
didn't write the grant alone. We wrote the grant with district people.
And it said in the grant that when at the end of three years, the district would
pick up the cost.
Why do you think that we're confused or feel misinformed about, I mean, there must be a lack of communication because it was our understanding that there wasn't going to be a cost to us. So why do you think that we...
Well, I guess the key is that we haven't ever had a discussion really with the board about it. And the people that were part of it, Gina Corona and Dave Carson, they're no longer here. And so I guess we feel, and I'm speaking for the Youth Court Committee that's been involved all along, is that we were kind of left out of the discussion too. And so, I mean, I have told Mr. Schroeder and I've told Dr. Jarrett, it isn't really about YSN, it's really about the kids. And yes, we've served 30, I think we're up to 37 kids. YSN has eaten the cost this first semester. We didn't stop because we didn't want the kids. We have the peer jurors, we have 143 of them trained. We're in all four schools at this point. We felt that it was important for the kids. And, you know, it isn't about YSN. It really isn't. And I've told Mr. Schroeder, if the district wants to do it internally, we'd be more than happy to train them. We've just trained Belvedere, who's starting it. Hananiga's interested in doing it. Peer courts are not something that is out of what's going on in the community and in the state.
So, and that's going forward, the discussion, the conversation, what
right.
we'll do next year. And I would just like to commend you. I know that you've been out there trying to get this funded. I know that you went to the county and you've done everything in your power because you believe in the program. Mm-hmm. And so I do want to say thank you for that. And, you know, what is it, 90% of the failing is communication, so...
Well, and I did write a grant to United Way for it that we didn't receive. I wrote a grant to the Mill Foundation. So I do feel that we've tried, and the committee has certainly backed us up to try to find the funding, but I do think it was what made it difficult was when the staff that were involved from the beginning left, and all of a sudden we were very surprised, too, at what happened. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Vosburg, anything else you want to add to that? Okay.
I think I'm fine.
Okay. I was thinking that wasn't part of it the link to the academy model and fitting in with the human services part of the high school academy redesign?
That's correct. Yeah. I think that larger benefit to the students, and I think there are other long-term implications. So, again, I think this, and to the county's credit, that they stepped forward to provide the lion's share of the funding for this year, and this was our attempt to give time to build a plan moving forward that has clarity. And I can assure you that the board will be involved in that communication. So this allows us the time to build the model correctly in terms of a long-term funding strategy and a long-term implementation strategy. I think some of those pieces are in place, but clearly, as both Mary Ellen pointed out and multiple board members have pointed out, there was a breakdown in communication. So our hope with this under $10,000 to go with the county's commitment gives us time to continue the program while we work on that communication plan and have clear tactics in place that allow the program to continue in a form that is acceptable to the board and to the community.
I'm gonna turn it over to Wendy Vaughn, who's been the head of the Youth Court Committee for 4 years.
Okay.
Good evening, everyone. My name's Wendy Vaughn. I'm a clinical associate professor at NIU College of Law, and I was invited by the school district as part of the Alignment Rockford process to join the College and Career Readiness Council for the Human and Public Services Committee. And just to be clear, the idea of peer juries and restorative justice in schools and how to address sort of thorny issues where criminal issues and social issues and educational issues meet in our schools came from the College and Career Readiness Council. My recollection is it didn't come from the county, it didn't come from the city, It came from a group of committed community members that included some folks from the county and included some folks from the city and a bunch of folks from nonprofits, from Rosecrans, from universities, who are all interested in this issue of how can we meet the needs of our students? How can we keep them in schools? And when they graduate from school, how can they transition into a career like a human and public services career? And unfortunately, a criminal record is a barrier. It's a barrier to becoming a lawyer. It's a barrier sometimes to becoming a police officer, a fireman, a nurse, a social worker, and sometimes maybe even a teacher. So this idea of how to reduce the criminal records of students was born of this work. And in looking at models of other schools, what we learned is that peer jurors themselves, who were students from the school, who were working with other students to think about the crimes that are committed at their schools, were really, really powerful. And that kids listen to each other in ways that are different than how they listen to adults. And that in schools that had very effective restorative justice practices, that the overall climate of the school tended to alter. Because a huge component of this program is developing the leadership skills of the peer jurors, who themselves take ownership of how their schools are conducted and are modeling for each other and for their classmates how to become model citizens and how to have a community that is engaged. And so our hope is that like other communities that have embraced these types of programs, that we'll see an overall change in the culture of schools where there's less behavioral issues overall. So whether the issues are criminal or disciplinary in nature or overlap, as they often do, what we've learned from studying this across a bunch of different other cities is that it is successful. But the idea of it wasn't necessarily a deterrent system. It wasn't to deter kids from the criminal justice system. The idea was how can we address crime in our schools in an innovative, restorative way to really look at the root issues that kids are facing and motivate them to make a change for the better, to give them the resources through all of these community partners to make a change in their lifestyle and to go down a different path. And how can we encourage and train and educate all of those peer jurors about potential careers as police officers, judges, lawyers? We've brought a whole group of peer jurors to NIU College of Law and DeKalb just to find out what is law school. Those are programs that are part of this youth court. So to characterize it as simply a deterrent model, a county or city criminal issue, I think sort of misses the mark on what we're trying to do.
Mr. Rollins.
You mentioned that Belvedere is going to implement it. What I was told is that the Belvedere School Foundation is paying for it. Do you know whether that's true?
That is true.
So it's not the school district itself?
No, it's not the school district. It's the foundation. In fact, I had asked Mr. Schroeder if Rockford had a foundation, if the Rockford School District had a foundation so we could apply.
I just want to make it clear, nobody is saying that this is a, I'm not saying that this is a bad program or that it's a bad idea or that it's not even a wonderful idea. What I am saying is that we are asked to juggle a lot of great ideas, far more great ideas than far more great ideas on how to fund them. And I was serious when I said, we tell our staff all the time, we don't have money for that.
You know what? I totally understand. Trust me, running a nonprofit with last year, what happened with the stopgap budget, I totally get it.
Yeah.
We just need an answer one way or the other.
Sure. Okay.
Because it's the discussion's kind of been going on for a very long time. Sure. And so if the answer is no, we totally understand. You know, we're very system savvy and realize that money is a huge issue and ideas change and people change. It's just really basically at this point, I really need an answer so that I can tell the school staff and I can tell the kids, you know what, we can't do this anymore.
Okay. Mr. Escobedo.
Yeah, can you speak a little bit as far as the, so the impact, you talked about 147 peer, just kind of wondering, like, what type of training do they go through, just to try to get a gauge for the impact, right, aside from the actual served, but those that have been trained as peer, what, you know, what kind of process do they go through?
Well, they go through 2 days, two full days of training on leadership skills and resources in the community. They get trained a little bit on domestic violence. They get trained on healthy relationships. They get trained on some criminal, you know, just some issues that they're going to be facing. The offenses that these children commit are misdemeanor offenses. It can only be their first offense. Usually it's something with drugs, it's a fight, it's something, you know, kind of minimal. So then the students do some, they do some practice. We do some practice peer. And then they also hear from the School of Law. Some of the attorneys come. We've taken them to the courthouse so that they can see a real court proceeding. So they get lots of different kinds of training. Interestingly, we've done like a million surveys with the kids, with the respondents, with the parents of the respondents. And what the kids say is that it makes them appreciate their families more, because when they come to youth court, it's not just the youth, the parent also comes. And the youth court members ask the parents, you know, how did what your child do impact you? And I mean, I've sat in on a lot of them, and to hear the parents say to the child, it wrecked your graduation. We had one situation where the family was here for the child's graduation and the child couldn't walk for graduation. And so to have that dad cry in front of his child and in front of the peer jurors was a tremendously emotional experience, not just for that child, but also for those peer jurors who made comments afterwards that they're gonna go home and hug their parents.
And out of those 147, approximately how many are actually getting involved in the process with the 37 being served?
Well, they have the option. Usually we have 10 to 12 peer jurors at a hearing. And I can tell you that, you know, we've taken two new ones this year. We've been finishing up last year's, but we haven't, you know, gone full force because we didn't know what would happen. And it's hard to hire people when you don't have money.
Thank you. This will be presented at our November 22nd board meeting for a vote then. Thank you for being here. Attorney Holy will present our next seven items, which are board policy revisions.
And these now are in smaller chunks for you guys
to... We appreciate that.
Yeah, delve into it deeper. The first policy change is to 7.40, which is the non-public, non-graded school students policy. And the changes are those that are recommended by the Illinois Association of School Boards. It has clarifying language regarding special education and extracurricular activities. The special education section on page 2 reflects federal law, which requires school districts to locate, identify, and evaluate children with disabilities, including those who reside in the district but who do not attend a public school. The extracurricular section on page 2 reminds everyone that certain extracurricular associations have eligibility criteria that students must meet in order to participate in those extracurricular activities. For example, the Illinois Association, a high school association, requires students to be enrolled in a public school and be taking a minimum of 25 credit hours in order to remain eligible to participate in those sports or other activities. Then policy 7.100.
Can I just ask a question about that?
Oh, sure. Rollins has a question.
Under students with a disability, that new language, you're missing something there. It's a comma, might be a comma and a word, but you just read that sentence because that needs to be revised.
Which sentence is it, Tim?
It's right under students with a disability.
It's missing.
the new language?
Children for whom?
No.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Got it. We'll fix that so it makes sense, which it doesn't currently. All right. 7.100 is the health and dental examinations policy and immunizations. And state law was changed to require students now to present proof of immunization against meningococcal disease, and so that policy is updated. 7.240, there's really no substance.
Question.
Oh.
Can you please explain, and I see that there's religious and health exemption on there, and so from a policy standpoint, we have the policy, but how do we make sure we adhere to it? Is it our nursing staff? I mean, I personally know of students in the district who haven't had their immunizations, and we haven't done anything, and they don't have a letter from their physician. So what do we do about that?
Right. Under state and federal law, we also have to make accommodations for religious beliefs or certain disabilities, which wouldn't allow immunizations, and so, but we do require them to present proof. So we did have at one time, I think one student tried to present, it was an odd religion, it was like religion of spaghetti or noodles or something, it was, which we denied, but it has to be a recognized religion.
The policy, is it in the state code then that indicates what the medical not restrictions, but exclusions are?
It's not that specific.
So it's really up to your physician to decide?
Yes.
And if we don't have a letter from a physician, what happens? Nobody, it doesn't tick out and there's nothing in the system that lets us know this?
No, if you don't have your immunizations, generally students are excluded. Now, the only other exception that's required is with homeless students who meet the homeless criteria. And then we have to work with them to give them additional extension, but it's still required unless they have another exemption, either religious or medical.
I guess then I would ask the question, do we have an IT situation that would,
and they
you know,
left.
That would kick it out? They left. That's all right. I can follow
I will
up.
Say Mary Fisher was always always very diligent about that. She was the nursing supervisor, and her replacement, which I don't recall the name, I'm sorry, but her replacement is being trained also by
sure.
Mary.
Sure.
So I know they have always been very diligent about it in the nursing staff.
Okay.
I think I was on 7.240, and there really are no substantive changes, but there's some clarifying language, some language changes that IASB had recommended, and in particular it reminds folks that participants in extracurricular activities must abide by the student code of conduct. 7.290 is the suicide and depression awareness, and there are changes in state law that requires the board to put in place a policy relating to suicide and depression awareness. And so the language in this policy mirrors that state law. 7.300 are the co-curricular athletics, and there, again, are really no substantive changes, but there's some clarifying language that IASB has recommended. 7.310, it's the restrictions on publications, and this policy outlines restrictions on school-sponsored publications as well as non-school-sponsored publications, and the updates are recommended by IASB. And include, first, a clarification to the definition of a non-school-sponsored publication, namely that such publications include material distributed on electronic devices such as voicemail, text messages, etc. So it's bringing it up to the modern age. And then, two, it's a reminder that the bullying and cyberbullying is prohibited. So that's consistent with other policies. 7.325, it's student fundraising activities, and again, the changes reflect IASB recommendations, which add more specificity regarding student fundraising activities, such as in including that participation in fundraising activities must be mandatory and student safety must be paramount. In addition, although this is already the practice, the policy specifies that student fundraising must be supervised by a school staff member. So if they're going to be raising funds for the student, for students in the schools or for the schools in general, it has to be supervised by a staff member.
And, are we following, I mean, because we have some new procedures or policies or processes in place, I believe, to track funds within a building. Mm-hmm. And so would they fall under those same, with those student monies? I mean, how are we going to guarantee that?
So different activities. I think we're still ironing out some of the kinks in the software that was implemented, and so for those certain accounts. So I don't know that I can specifically answer how that is, because that's really not the policy.
If I remember correctly on that software, that was really to track school-based fundraisers. I don't believe it really covered something that would be done by the students. This is, because that's not official, huh?
Yeah, this is school-based, the student fundraising.
Oh, this is, okay, so it's...
So it would be like cheerleaders who are selling candy or bows or things like that, or...
Then that should be, if it's school, I mean, it's essentially school-sponsored then.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So then that should be under that software, because it's got the ability to track whatever activities by the schools, so.
So I guess the short answer is that we have implemented different cash handling procedures. Mm-hmm. That's not really part of this particular policy, but it goes with it, along with it. So it's kind of coordinated with it as well. So,
okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I understand it's not part of the policy, but I also want to make sure that we're, you know, that kids aren't just setting up a business in the school on their own, because we did have that at one point in time. And that if students do collect money, that it goes to the organization it's meant to, where it's meant to land.
Right, and we can always do a better job of really implementing more controls on that, but yes, there are controls out there.
Is that it?
It is.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Mr. Schmidt, you want to hobble up here? And
Yes, you have three land acquisition purchases here. As I mentioned earlier, one of these was actually an eminent domain that you approved back in September that we've negotiated a price with the tenant, landlord. So these are all for the Kishwaukee school expansion.
Great. How are we doing with the percentages of properties you want to acquire versus how many you actually have acquired?
Of the... There's 53 parcels, one is ours, so we've acquired that one. There's 52 parcels we need to acquire, and with these three on tonight, that's a total of 23 that we will have under contract, and there's actually one vacant lot out there. So
Okay. We're
doing pretty good for the short amount of time.
Mr. Rollins.
I'm just wondering what the schedule is for the demolition then, because we don't want these sitting empty, obviously.
Part of this is we talked with it, because we have a couple intergovernmental agreements out there where the county's going to give us money to help with the land acquisition and the demo of this. The city, we have given them a list of all the properties that we have out there, and we're trying to work in conjunction with them, because this is going to be part of their contribution to this. We have our environmental contractor ready to go. So as soon as we close on all these houses, we're looking at the ones that are where the building's going to sit, which is the high priority ones of about 22 properties right there that are south of Caitlin and north of Gregory, west of Kishwaukee. So that's where the physical building is. So those are the ones we're looking at just Soon as we get them closed, we're going to get in there with our abatement contractor, see if there's any environmental issues in there, and start getting them done. We're working with a tree contractor to hurry up and get the trees out there. So we want to have those in the next 4 or 5 months on those properties where the site is going to be for the actual physical location of the building demoed. Because when we bid out the first school in December, we want to start in the spring of 2017.
Are there any that we're buying that we're not going to have demolished immediately?
Yes.
Are we taking steps to make sure those are secure? And
yes, we are. As we go out there, as we close on the property and I get the keys, we'll go out there and we'll survey it. I had maintenance guys come out there and get some more locks that were boarding up the windows, and we're actually looking if there's anything in the buildings that is going to be salvageable for the district. So we are locking and boarding them up.
Ms. McCullough.
So that begs the question of would we be waiting because we're waiting for the city to demolish them, or we're waiting for us to demolish them because we have the money, right? We've already gotten our bonds.
Yes, we have all the money for this. We have a portion for ours. But as you look at this, of the 14-acre site that we're looking at, we're getting the commitment from the other entities to help us out there. So if I need to go in there and to use our money just to get with the buildings that are where we're going to build the new school, I'm not worried about a building that's north of Kishwaukee Street that's going to be green space that I really don't need that until another 18 months. So that's why we're looking at those. Once I get all the IGAs in place, it's easy with the county. The county's great. They're just going to give us cash. We can go at it. With the city, is going to work on some of their blight reduction grant to get some of these properties for demolition. That's why we met with the city, gave them all the properties, and seeing how they're going to contribute it and waiting for that IGA to actually come to the board, too.
So are you looking for them to demolish just the ones then where you're going to build, or are you also looking for them to assist with those others?
If they go through their process, because a lot of this, they're using the grant, there's some stipulations on that grant, which they explained to me, that if they can get some of those done here, if not, then I'm just going to go in and those 22 buildings, just get those demoed and done and let the city worry and the rest of the funding that comes through the county and some of the private investment to look at basically everything north of Caitlin Street.
And do we look at using this as an educational experience in any way with construction or Youth Build or any of the other groups that might
yes.
be able to learn something in that process?
I've made contact with Nick. Butenoff, yeah. Thank you. Sorry. Put it out there. He put it out to some of the construction classes that there's a couple of the buildings like over by Kishwaukee that have some great woodworking and things inside. So I've offered that up to them that they can come in and do selective deconstructing of the buildings, kind of like we did with the admin building where we let the theater department at Auburn come out there. So we've had made contact with them, and I'm going to take them through some of these buildings to see if they need anything.
Well, and there was an article in the paper, did anybody see it this weekend, with Ray Howard, I think it was, and using some of the,
recycled.
But bringing people back online for work after they've been incarcerated and working on taking down buildings and stripping them and then actually selling the pieces, and they were making enough selling the woodwork and the metal and all mm-hmm. those for Restore, they were to pay a wage.
Yeah.
So bigger picture, community, but even
yeah. We are looking at this, and some of these buildings you pretty much don't want to go in unless you have a breathing apparatus because
yeah,
it's mold infested. And so we're looking at them on a case-by-case basis. So we're going to start with our own students in there if they want to do it with a construction class or they need it for some of their theater departments, and then we'll go from there.
Thank you. This will be presented at our November 22nd board meeting for a vote. Are there any other items for tonight? If not, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, say aye. Opposed, same sign. We are adjourned at 8:34. Yes.
This is the most important thing.
I'm not going.